IVM.
If you like IVM likes, you should definitely check out another show from the IVM network called Geek Fruit. It's a show where three geeks, Tejas, Jishnu and Dinkar, talk about everything science fiction, adventure, fantasy, movies, TV shows, everything. So quench your thirst for geek conversation every week. Episodes out every Monday and Thursday on the IVM podcast app, the IVM website or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Hello and welcome to another episode of IVM Likes. In the studio today we have Abbas.
Hi.
Alika.
Oh, hi.
Shlok.
Hello.
And I'm Saishree. What's up, guys? How are you doing on this glorious Monday morning?
Amazing. Did you just say studio? In the studio today with me is...
Really? Did I say that?
It seemed like
the
that.
The pseudo studio.
Sounded like that.
Pseudo studio. Sure. Works.
Yeah.
Must be a new thing.
I like it.
How's your weekend? Cool weekend.
It was good actually. I was at home the entire weekend. I didn't go out. And
Alex,
I binged on things, nice, which I will recommend now.
Alex, what'd you do?
I had a very cat-filled weekend.
Oh, can I add it? Yeah.
Can I add that in my recommendation? Hey guys, go to Cat Cafe Studio in Warsaw. It's really nice.
Great. Shloki, what did you do?
I had quite a disappointing weekend.
Wow.
I planned to watch The Lion King on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. All plans failed.
Oh, man.
I planned
Maybe
to watch
that movie is just not meant for you.
Meant for you, I don't. So
I planned to watch Super 30. That failed.
Wow.
Oh, why did that fail?
Because my parents backed out last minute.
Oh, Super 30. Okay. Acha.
Not bad, not bad. Wow. I had a crazy weekend.
Okay.
It just involved me and another great friend of ours from office making fun of this poor couple that broke up right next to us at the Lali.
The entire weekend?
Well, yeah, the joke carried on throughout the weekend. Like, okay, every time we spoke about it, it was just like, I'm still breaking up with you.
Wow.
Yes. Today, for a round of recommendations, let's start with Abbas.
All right. So, over the weekend, I binged watched this show, animated show on Netflix called Final Space. Mm-hmm. I'd been meaning to see it for a long time. I finally got down to watching it. It is it's a science fiction show. Mm-hmm. It's very crazy. It's very out there. It's made and created by this guy called Olan Rogers, who initially he has the knowledge of animation and cartooning.
Right.
So he made a few episodes and put it up on his YouTube channel. And someone from Conan O'Brien's team happened to watch it while they were like stoned.
Oh.
Okay.
They were.
And they brought it up to Conan like, you've got to see this, you've got to see this. And Conan O'Brien was like, what is this bullshit you keep showing me when you're stoned? He watched it. He loved it so much. He's like, I want to pick this up for a series. All right.
Oh,
so shit. He brought it up. He's the executive producer of the show. The animation obviously improves leaps and bounds, mm-hmm, from YouTube to now on Netflix. So the basic premise of the show, again, it's very crazy. So I'll give you like the very basic plot of it. Our protagonist is a guy called Gary Goodspeed. Okay. He's serving a 5-year prison sentence on a spaceship in space. His crime is that he wanted to impress a girl, and in the process of impressing her, he took down an entire cavalry of the military and blew up a Mexican restaurant. Okay.
Wait, is this a kid's animated
No,
thing?
It's not. No.
Okay.
It's very much meant for adults. Okay.
Oh, I see.
So he's serving this prison sentence of 5 years, and he has no other human being on the spaceship. It's a huge spaceship. He only has other robots to serve him and help him out. And he has to basically clean the spaceship.
Right.
He has to carry out all those things. And as a companion, he's been given an android called Kevin.
Okay.
Who's called Kevin, but his name is Kevin because his serial number is KVN.
Oh,
so he calls him Kevin, and he's essentially there to make sure he doesn't go insane in the loneliness. So he's essentially an android therapist, but he's irritating AF. Okay. So Gary hates him, and there is a weird sort of, they have a canteen. Okay. The canteen only serves cookies, but because Gary is a prisoner, he can't access those cookies.
Oh.
He can only access, but Kevin can, and Kevin can't even eat because he's an android, but just to make him jealous, he would take out the cookies and break them in front of him. Okay.
That's evil.
That's just the pilot. Okay. So at the end of the pilot, Gary happens to meet a very cuddly green alien who he names Mooncake. Okay.
Aww.
He's very cute, he's very cuddly, but what Gary doesn't know is that alien is a planet destroyer.
Oh shit.
So this sets off a chain of reaction of events happening. There is a Dark Lord who is in pursuit of this alien because he wants to use the alien as a weapon. And over the next 10 episodes, there is time travel, there is planet hopping, there is absolute insane adventures that they go on. He meets a bounty hunter who looks like a cat and he's called Avocado.
I love this.
He has a son who has been imprisoned by the Dark Lord, so he has to get the son back.
Is the son also like a cat?
It's a kitten.
Oh shit, I love this.
His name is Cato.
Oh great. So this
sets off a chain of reactions. It's 10 episodes long. It's absolutely insane. If you like Guardians of the Galaxy, if you like Futurama, this is totally up your alley. It is absolutely insane.
I feel like this is what the base story for like Rick and Morty's Rick would
kind
be.
Of, yeah. A lot of people have compared this to Rick and Morty, but I actually found this better or at least more watchable than Rick and Morty's. Rick and Morty's like a little too out there. This is
just existential crisis all the time.
I'm so confused. Why has Netflix not recommended this to me? I'm probably the one who watches all the animation stuff on Netflix. I haven't seen even a promo of this.
Because maybe you're not so much into adult cartoons.
That's
so
true. I find them boring.
Maybe that's why.
But wait, what is the style of animation? Is it like noodly arm or is it like Simpsons?
No, it's not exactly. Like the space sort of backgrounds and the technology that they've shown is actually like really impressive. Okay. It's very colorful. It's very like science fiction-y. It's if you like science fiction, you'll find the images familiar.
Cool.
Great.
But yeah, it is. I mean, as and when as required, the animation style changes also. So it's very much up your alley if you're into science fiction or humor. Please watch it. It's 10 episodes, half an hour for each episode.
If you like funny things,
if you like to laugh.
So Final Space is my recommendation.
Okay, that's great.
Alika, what do you have for us today?
Wow, I'm going to recommend something I bet nobody expected me to recommend. A musical. That's not exactly true. I'm going to recommend an album. But it's such a good album. They made a musical of it, which is on Broadway. And it's won a bunch of Tonys. So get strapped into your seats. So this album, okay, is by Vermont-based artist Anais Mitchell. I hope I'm pronouncing her name correctly. Because it's got that I with two dots and I don't know how to pronounce that.
Oh, okay.
But Anais Mitchell, released in 2010, it is an album called Hades Town and the musical is also named after this.
Oh, cool.
So it's a folk opera and it's so cool, you guys. So it's about this Greek mythology story of Orpheus and Eurydice.
Okay.
I think I pronounced that name. Eurydice. There we go. Orpheus and Eurydice, and it follows the same story that, you know, Eurydice gets taken by Hades to hell, and Orpheus has to go and rescue her. But this is set in like 1920s Great Depression era. So, you know, like the whole setting is that Hades, the area of hell, is like a town where people go and mine and stuff, and people are rich there. At least that's what they project. And Eurydice is tempted by this because obviously during the Great Depression, everyone was poor and didn't have food to eat. So she goes and follows Hades down, and Orpheus is like, "What? We were going to get married." And then he goes and tries to find her. And then if you know the ending of the myth, you'll know kind of how this ends. But if you don't, I'm going to leave you in suspense. It's about an hour long album. So the album is also follows a story, and it's very like concise. Like, you know what the songs are doing and you can follow the plot. And they made a musical out of it. They made like a bunch more songs into that. So you can probably find the musical recording somewhere on YouTube. But you should definitely listen to this album as well. It's not just Anais Mitchell who is singing. She plays a part of Eurydice. Justin Vernon plays the part of Orpheus. You may know him as lead vocalist and guitarist of Bon Iver. So if you like that sort of music, it's there in this album. It's got really good music. It's very, like, there are some songs which are like super sinister, and then there are some very upbeat songs. It's great. I love this album so much. I've been listening to it on repeat for the last 3 days.
Great. Since Shlok has nothing to recommend, I am going to go next. So this entire weekend I spent A, one, very sick, and B, very hungover.
Okay.
So, and I didn't have the brain capacity to watch anything like hardcore. I couldn't.
Are you recommending a drunk, sick
hungover
weekend?
No. No, I'm not recommending that. I don't wish that upon anyone. But it's like I was going through Amazon Prime and I was trying to look for something very feel good, lighthearted, and I came across this animation called Cheese Sweet Adventure.
Okay.
So Cheese Sweet Adventure is about a cat that lives with a modern family, like a nuclear family.
Not the show Modern Family.
It's a nuclear family. It's the parents, one son, and the cat herself. And the cat can, and it's the series from the perspective of the cat. So how she sees, and she's a very notorious little cat.
No.
So she can talk, but the family can't hear her. So according to the family, it just meows. And you get to see both perspectives of how she reacts to certain situations. So the first episode is, it's her birthday and the family ignores her all day long. And her, like, her anger towards the family. And it's just like how she plans on running away from home.
Aww.
But then she sees huge dogs on the street and she's scared.
No.
Because it's a small little kitten.
No.
And then when she finally comes back home, she comes back home to a party.
Aww.
So it's like, it's short stories like that. And it's 20 minutes each per episode. So it's very short watch. And I binge watch the whole thing. And I swear, it's like the cutest little thing. Because the anime, so it's basically anime. I mean, it's a Japanese cartoon. So I'd suggest you watch it with subtitles. Watch it. No,
helps.
Like, you don't watch the dubbed version. Because the dubbed version kills like the effect of it, because with the voice that they chose for the cat and the family members, it becomes more cuter.
Okay.
Yeah, so you watch it with subtitles, and it's like, the animations are also so cute. Like, I can't, they're 3D animations, they're not your regular anime, how they, like the 2D anime. They're 3D anime and it's very cute. So yeah, that's my recommendation. You can find it on Amazon Prime.
I cannot believe.
Cheese Sweet Adventure.
I cannot believe that I am the one who didn't recommend an animated thing today.
Oh, and like, the original is from a manga. So the manga is called Cheese Sweet Home.
Oh.
Yeah, and the adapted version is Cheese Sweet Adventure. Yeah.
It sounds adorable.
Yes.
I will check it out.
So, wrapping up, Abbas, what did you recommend?
Final Space.
Alika.
I recommended a music album called Hades Town by Anais Mitchell.
Okay. And I recommended a TV series, basically. An animated show on Amazon Prime called Cheese Sweet Adventure. And we'll go in for a break with that. After the break, you get to hear my Gen Z word of the week.
Of course.
And then we discuss animations to live action.
Yeah.
And it's all Disney animations, live actions, or any animation that we've watched. And
it's pretty
the
much
necessity
Disney.
For them. So, okay, catch you after the break.
Hey everybody, welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I know that you guys are making fun of this promo on social media. Please continue to do so. That seems like, as long as you keep listening, I don't care if you make fun of it. I wanted to, again, just reiterate, we're hiring at the best place in the world to work at. That's the IVM Podcast Network. We're looking for producers, content creators, audio engineers, developers, photographers, business people, all kinds of roles. Go check out our careers page, ivmpodcast.com/careers. We're really happy to announce the second season of Marvel's Lost and Found, which premieres on the 23rd of July. This season, Zen and Avanti cover issues like addiction, mental health in kids, grief, eating disorders, and more. There are a number of special guests that will be on the podcast. Catch new episodes every Tuesday. On Cyrus Says, Supreme Court lawyer and founder of Swayam Pharma Foundation, Harshit Kohli talks to Cyrus about how he got started with Swayam, their objectives, and why people in cities need to take more interest in farming. Also, in case you missed it, check out Cyrus's review of the 2019 World Cup Final with comedian Mikhail Almeida on last week's cricket special, Lanso. On the Ronnie Screwala podcast, Ronnie and I discuss the chapter second innings, where Ronnie updates us about his current ventures and talks about how problem solving is different in a nonprofit organization. On the Filter Coffee podcast, Karthik is joined by award-winning journalist and fellow podcaster Amit Verma. They discuss India's performance in the 2019 Cricket World Cup, sports analytics, and poker. On the Empowering series, Zarina is joined by two guests, theater and TV actor Binaf Dada Chanji and Chinese chef and serial entrepreneur Norman Ho. Together, they talk about their 10-year relationship, the importance of commitment and loyalty, and how one should sustain, grow, and evolve in a relationship. On our Kannada podcast, Thalle Harate, Pavan talks to researcher Lingaraj Jayaprakash about Buchanan's journey, offering a unique insight into the life and times of the regions he traveled at the dawn of the 19th century. On Geek Fruit, Jishnu is joined by the IVM staffers, Abbas and Alika, to talk about Stranger Things' latest season. And with that, let's get you on with your show.
Hello and welcome back to another episode of IVM Likes. In the studio we have today Abbas, Alika, Shlok,
and starting the show all over again?
No, okay. I just wanted to recap.
Okay, hi again guys.
Hi.
Yeah.
Okay. And my Gen Z word of the week is here. So this week's word is fuego. Now fuego is Spanish for fire. Mm-hmm. Okay, and this is like an upgrade to the word lit. Because lit is very 2018.
That's just 1 year ago. I just wanted to
know. So, if I like something, I'm like, this show is fuego.
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 Yeah, so like, every time I hear Tom Misch's album, I'm like, this album is full fuego.
Fuego.
Yeah, so you have to add full before.
If it's that great, then it's full. Like, so the superlative to fuego is full fuego.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
That using it in a sentence, Tom Misch's entire album is full fuego.
You know what else is fuego? IVM Likes.
Yes! Full fuego. IVM Likes is full fuego.
Yes.
So, yeah, with that, I end my Gen Z word of the week.
It was fuego.
Yes.
I can't, like, not hear it in my head in a Spanish accent. It's a Spanish word.
It's a Spanish word.
Fuego.
Fuego.
I can't believe
it. I can just hear Bart Simpson just saying it with Aikaramba, just like, hey, fuego. Aikaramba. Sorry, that just went like, hey, bye.
I'm going to try and incorporate all these words into my talk at some point.
Do it. I'm telling
That's
you.
That's going to be interesting.
Like, people are just going to look at you like you're crazy, but then you know you're like one level up. You're just.
Yeah.
And yeah,
I feel like that photo of. I don't even remember what show it is, but it's that old guy with a skateboard saying, how do you do, fellow kids?
That's from 30 Rock. The guy. Steve Buscemi.
Great. Okay, so for our segment of discussion, we are going to discuss all movies that have been converted from animations to live actions or from stories to live actions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, the latest being Lion King.
The Lion King, yes. I have some very strong feelings about this. Mm. But
when did you see it?
No, I didn't see the Lion King remake, but I have seen the original back when it was in the theaters, which was I was coming to.
Everyone has seen it.
No, but I'm pretty sure you weren't even around when the
My parents
first
were still
one.
Dating. When
exactly.
Yeah.
And Shlok, how old are you?
I'm 22. So
even
I'm
you weren't
sure
around when the original Lion King came around.
But you must have seen it.
Of course I saw it, but not in theaters.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. So, especially the recent... So, I think I am not against Disney remaking them with live action, okay? But the films they choose is very important, right? So, like when they did the Jungle Book remake, perfect film to remake into live action because it came out in 67. It's not one of the... classic Disney movies.
It kind of silver era, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. It kind of needed an upgrade because it was like, it's except for bare necessities, there's no other like epic thing that it's known for. So you choose Jungle Book, great. I think it did a very good job with Jungle Book. They updated it the right amount. They added some, in the original Jungle Book, there are four vultures which are based on the Beatles. Okay, literally, down to the Liverpoolian accent. Okay, at least they weren't in the new Jungle Book.
I wanted them.
So it's like whatever you eliminated them. You made it more streamlined, more kind of a little more dark than the original. Fine, right? A couple of years back, they did a Cinderella remake, which is actually quite good. Yeah. Kenneth Branagh. Directed it, the guy who played Gilderoy Lockhart in Chamber of Secrets. It's a very good movie. But when you come to films like Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, The Lion King, and the thing is, you're not even updating them. You're pretty much making them
the same movie as
they were. That's what I have a problem because I didn't go watch the original Aladdin because at the remake Aladdin because I'm like I saw the original. It's just too fresh in my mind.
Honestly, it was a big letdown.
It
just seemed like a Will Smith show.
Yeah,
and the story was like the movie's named Aladdin. Just give me some more.
Maybe show me the story from a different character's perspective.
Yeah.
Maybe do something.
And they didn't even update the story. Okay, if you're going to make it like a big genie movie,
right.
At least make the movie from genie's perspective.
perspective. Yeah, exactly. But and I hear the Lion King is even more like a blueprint replica.
It's literally all the same scene.
It is. Exactly. It is. Yeah. It is.
So I'm like, then and on top of that, you're watching it like the National Geographic animals. There's less of emotions.
Yeah,
and
did you see that that tweet of somebody who just like pasted, copy-pasted dialogue of the Lion King onto National Geographic?
Yeah.
And it freaking looked way better. Yeah. Because those lions had emotion.
Like the whole impact of Simba being "It feels great to be king," the song didn't have any impact.
It's so colorful in the animated show.
Yeah.
So I'm like, make them, but choose the lesser known Disney films and remake them into live action rather than
Aristocats.
Lady and I think they're doing a Lady and the Tramp for their Disney Plus service.
Oh.
If you take some movies like that, fine. But Aladdin, Lion King, Hunchback of Notre Dame, all very fresh in my mind.
I think, like you said, if you update it, if you like, you know, try to add some things, it could still probably work out. I mean,
they're working. Aladdin did amazing business. Lion King did amazing business.
That's true, but they're working on the basis of previous glory.
Yeah, they're working on nostalgia factor. That's literally the only thing drawing people to watch it. I wasn't going to watch Lion King, and then I was like, what sort of fan am I if I don't go and watch Lion King in the theater again?
I went
it
to
was
watch
so disappointing.
Lion King in Hindi and in English.
Wow.
Whoa. And honestly, here's the thing, no? Watching it in Hindi is another like full Bollywood.
Right.
It felt like I was watching like a full Dharma production movie.
Who's voiced Timon and Pumbaa in the Hindi versions?
Wait. I'll tell you. Timon was this one, wait. One second.
I know Ashish Vidyarthi's
car. Timon is Shreyas Talpade and Pumbaa is...
Comedy Circus only.
Wait. No, while
Saishree googles who Timon... No, who Pumbaa is. What about you, Shlok? You were saying something.
So I was saying that, like you said, you know, definitely the emotions and things like that is it's more expressive in animation. You can do a lot more with animation.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of it.
Oh, okay. Oh, yes. That's an interesting actually.
I love Sanjay Mishra.
Even
but
I do.
Dude, like, I feel like, okay, firstly, if in the movie, Aryan Khan and Shah Rukh Khan sound exactly the same.
Okay.
But for some reason, as Simba, Aryan Khan did it justice. Like, he did it full justice. I think the casting for this was great, putting Shah Rukh and Aryan together. Mm. Considering that Aryan is also going to make his, like, Bollywood debut next year or the year after.
Okay.
Is it 21? I think so.
Well, there you go. Now it's going to make money even in Hindi. Yeah. People are going to go, they are curious what Shah Rukh Khan's son sounds like.
Yeah.
I think but on a larger thing, what happens is, I just feel that animation, hand-drawn animation ages well, whereas CGI doesn't.
Doesn't, yeah.
Right? So when, like the live-action Aladdin will seem dated 3-4 years from now when someone looks back and be like, it was Will Smith, but Will Smith's CGI seems dated now. Whereas if you watch the 1992 Aladdin, it still looks... I mean, forget Aladdin. Yeah. The Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs from 1937 still looks so gorgeous.
Steamboat Willie still looks great.
Great, yeah. So that's the thing. I mean, it makes me even more frustrated because they know it's a cash grab. They know CGI doesn't age well, right?
Yeah.
So 5 years from now, the new Lion King will seem older than the original one because they're like, it's not this. Computer graphics have.
And I don't
think
anyone's going to reach for the live action. Like, even with Aladdin.
Yeah.
Like, even now, if you say you want to watch Lion King, but you'll reach for the animated one thinking, like, yes, this is what I want to watch. I don't think anyone's going to reach for the
remake, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. Another generation of children, maybe. Like, this was someone's kid's first Lion King.
Yeah.
Just like the original
that,
was
that
mine.
That breaks my heart, honestly. like think that this was their first Lion King. Like, because I watched Lion King when I was 5 is when I watched Lion King for the first time.
Yeah.
And my dad got it in one of those pirated CDs where you get 1 in 100 films together.
Right.
So I watched it in like a very chill, like a pirated way, but I still watched it. While there was time for me to watch it.
How much did you cry when you watched it first?
Dude, don't ask. Like, I cried a lot. I still cried. I cried both the times in the theater. In Hindi, it was even more dramatic. I ugly cried.
I wanted... So here's the thing. Lion King is one of my favorite movies ever. I wanted to feel some emotion. I could not. All the creatures' eyes were dead. They were dead. They were like zombies. They didn't move. Like even if you see a normal cat, mm-hmm. when it wants something, you know, it kind of does things with its face. Like it moves its ear back. It kind of has like these, not eyebrows, but like, you know, the eye whisker things. Yeah. They move around. This was like, I'm watching a shell, which is being like, I don't know, puppeted from inside or something. It was very awkward to watch.
But I think I gotta give it to like Donald Glover as Simba. I genuinely enjoyed his voice.
Okay.
I genuinely enjoyed his voice. I enjoyed Seth Rogen as Pumbaa. I love Seth Rogen in general. Mm-hmm. Like even like Sausage Party has to be one of my favorite movies because it is like terrible jokes, sexual jokes, and this is the shit that I enjoy wholeheartedly. Oh my god, I loved it so much. And John Oliver as Zazu was.
That was John Oliver?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was John Oliver. And like, here's the thing. I never envisioned like John Oliver as Zazu ever. Mm. Like, if you had told me this earlier, like I found out it was John Oliver while I was going through the credits. I was like, holy shit, wait.
Have you guys seen Trevor Noah addressing this? And he's like, oh, you wanted a late night talk show host of to play an African character who is in Africa? I wonder.
Good one.
Oh, and Beyonce as Nala.
Oh yeah, how was she? I mean, there's so much hype.
I think Beyonce was Beyonce.
Oh,
like okay. Beyonce was just Beyonce. Like, there's no.
Did the lioness break into all the single lionesses?
Terrible joke. How'd you get your job as a stand-up comedian?
That's the reason I'm doing this and not at a gig. But no, yeah, when I think of the original Lion King, Nala didn't really have that many lines to begin with.
Yeah.
So is she given like more to
I
do?
Think no.
She's given like two more lines.
Two more lines, Not a lot more, but I feel like.
Also, I mean, Jeremy Irons is Scar. I mean, like, come on, you can't top that.
No.
So, but then I haven't seen the new one, so I don't know.
No, he didn't top it.
Chiwetel.
Yes, I cannot say his name. And you know what? Right before this recording, I like listened to his name 40 million times, like try and pronounce his name so I don't get it wrong. And I did exactly just that. I butchered the poor guy's name. But yeah, I mean, I think Beyonce as Nala, she did well, but like it wasn't Beyonce voice. It was like Beyonce's animated voice.
Right.
So it didn't feel like it. Mm. But I think I was very flawed by Donald Glover as Simba. Okay. So I think that's where it went all out for me.
But can I? So we've shit on it quite a bit. But I saw the Mulan trailer and that actually looks gorgeous.
I haven't yet.
Have you seen it?
I saw
Alika?
The trailer, yeah.
And you didn't like it?
No, I didn't have any opinion on it because I've not seen the movie. But I appreciate the fact that they're trying to make it more authentic to the actual historical figure. Mm-hmm.
No, also I think something like Mulan lends itself more to a live action.
Yeah, because
it's epic, like, it's war, it's battle. So,
also because there's humans in it.
That's humans
in it. Like it makes sense to make a live action. And plus I think they, now that after Jasmine wasn't received as well in Aladdin.
Right.
So I feel like they have to like one up themselves and like kind of make up for what they did wrong with Jasmine. Because they essentially cast like a white person for Jasmine.
Yeah.
So with Mulan, I think they're trying to cover up their tracks. And two, it's an easier remake for them.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not as much CGI as you would think.
Yeah, that makes for a good live action remake.
I feel like live action, which basically just casts human for like human based stories,
right?
It's just like a fan casting because then everyone gets excited about the whole fan cast, which I feel is like the point of it. I don't otherwise see really any point in making a live action.
I get that,
Because I don't know. There's a little mermaid live action film that's gonna come.
Yeah,
so.
And it's that's caused some whirlwind on Twitter.
I know,
dude. I was going through Twitter and like I didn't know that they had already like released the name of who was going to play.
It's an African American
girl. And
how dare they?
I didn't ask for a black Ariel.
They were like, what? You know what they said? They said this is redhead erasure. And I'm like, what?
I was like, listen, like for Ghost in the Shell, you got Scarlett Johansson of all people when you've got like great, you've got Shay Mitchell, you've got so many other like great Asian, like Asian American actors who can play Ghost in the Shell that would do so much better justice to Ghost in the Shell. But then
Did you all see? So Marvel announced that slate of films to come. And the last one they did was they announced a solo Black Widow movie, which is going to come next year. And they ended it with a Blade announcement. And Mahershala Ali. And someone tweeted, "It's quite generous of Scarlett Johansson to let go of Blade and actually do the Black Widow movie."
Wow,
oh,
man, this is a lot of shade.
I think we're just being shady because I think all of us hold like a very special part of our hearts with the original animated movies.
But here's the thing, like live action or CGI animated movies can work really well. For example, Detective Pikachu was awesome.
Yeah, but Detective Pikachu was a whole new story.
I agree, yeah.
It was a fully new story.
And like I don't think anyone expected Pikachu to turn out the way it did. Like Pikachu to have a voice.
Yeah.
Per se. So that was also a cool new element that they added to it.
It was an experiment which worked.
I mean, it was well received for sure.
But I mean, talking about bad CGI, did you guys see the trailer of this film called Cats?
No, listen, it is not bad CGI. Let me.
It is terrible.
It is unsettling. It is not bad.
It's weird. It's.
I agree.
It's
they should
Ian
have
Ian McKellen and Judi Dench as cats.
You know, they should have
and James Corden.
Yeah, I know.
And they don't have. I don't know. It's like you can't figure out at what point the costume ends and the CGI begins.
No, they should. I agree. They should have stuck with the musical costumes. Cats is, by the way, a musical which is famous or infamous.
Hamilton of its time.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I don't think I'm going to compare.
This just
Andrew
looks
Lloyd
creepy.
It is.
Seems
it's
like
so
it's like,
creepy.
Oh my god!
I'm going to have to sit 2.5 hours of that in a movie theater.
Dude, this feels like it's like a cult gone wrong.
Listen, I'm going to watch that because I have never gotten to see Cats the musical and I wanted to. So this is as close as I'm going to get. I feel like musicals are a good thing to make into movies.
But
because
are you going to be able to ignore like the jarring, weird cat? I don't know what skin suit that they're wearing that's in front of your face at all times for 2.5 hours.
I have ignored worse.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So there you go. There is an audience for everything.
Listen, I would watch a musical made into a live action or CGI movie because, I cannot watch a musical all the time, okay? It costs hundreds of dollars.
Disney films are essentially that, right? The musicals.
But they are movies. I'm saying like actual theater musicals.
Okay, cool.
Which I cannot actually go and watch because they cost a shit ton of money. Plus they are never on this side of the world.
That's true. Mm. Yeah.
So that's a good thing to make into a movie so that people can see it.
I guess so. Yeah. Sure.
Whatever.
The
man,
thing is like I mean so I don't know, I'm not a kid anymore in case you guys didn't notice. So like today's kids do live action, does live action stuff appeal to them more than cartoons?
No, I don't think so.
So then who is Disney making these films for?
For to protect their IP. as Alika mentioned very jarringly right before this recording, that we can start a conspiracy theory. Let's do this. This conspiracy, IVM conspiracy theory about these live action movies is they're doing this to protect their IP.
Yeah.
According to Alika's research, that after a certain amount of years, if you don't make a...
Yeah,
let's
if you don't use them,
use the movies in other
use
ways.
Use the property.
Use the property. Otherwise, rather than making merchandise, it becomes public property.
It goes into open domain, but there is a public domain.
Domain, okay.
Yeah, but there is like a time period. It's like a good 70, 80 years. So it's not like, you know, you
and
have
Disney's
to
been around for that.
Yeah.
Long,
yeah.
Kind of.
Yeah. Yeah. So like the older properties, that's probably why they like.
So, but The Lion King was made in 1994.
Yeah, because they must have made Sleeping Beauty and they were like, oh, everyone's falling for this. Let's make more money.
That's true.
That's a very logical explanation.
Yeah.
I mean, see, we all hated on it, but everyone's going to go and watch it, right?
Yeah. But Beauty and the Beast was the highest grossing film of that year, 2018 or 2017 when it came out. So we can hate as much as we want.
Yeah,
Disney is going to
you
the
know,
bank
they're not
happily.
Really making this for kids. They're just
exactly,
making
that's
it
my
for
point.
Us. They're making it for the people who grew up watching this and are like...
Who have kids now are like, I love this and you better love it as well. Yeah. So come with me.
I think
we have you by the collar. Come
No, I feel like I can't force anyone to watch Lion King and just be like, you have to like it.
No.
It's just that if you hate on it next to me, I'll probably murder you in your sleep. That's it.
Noted.
Noted.
Yeah.
But what's the one Disney movie you would like to see as a live action film?
I think with Mulan, because there is so much to it. Okay. And if they try and switch up the story a little bit, I mean, I love the story as is. Mulan happens to be my favorite Disney princess there is.
Okay.
Apart from Jasmine herself. That is why I was very disappointed with Aladdin. But sure, that's a topic for another day.
Cool.
Yeah, so Mulan, I'm looking forward to it.
What about you, Shlok? One Disney film or animated film you would like to see live action?
To be honest, it was always Jungle Book.
Oh, which you got.
And that kind of happened.
Okay then.
So I was quite happy. I love that live action.
Oh, okay. Did you see the Andy Serkis version as well?
Yeah, I did.
And it's good?
No. I mean, yeah, of course.
No, I'm asking genuinely.
It was good. I mean, but...
I
it's like some movies you want to like, so
but
you probably like them more.
Like the Lion
so
King.
You don't know. Yeah. So you don't know whether you actually really like them or not.
Okay.
I saw the trailer for that one and I got a little scared.
Okay.
It looked very
weird. It is
weird.
Quite dark. Yeah.
No. It just looked weird. The animation looked odd to me. I was like, is this what a wolf looks like?
Hmm.
I'm feeling very disturbed right now. Okay. So I'm not gonna watch that.
What about you? One animated film that you'd like to see live action?
I was going to say Aristocats, but then it's literally just cats, isn't it? maybe like, what's it called? Is it called the Black Cauldron or is it called the Sword in the Stone?
Ah, the Black Cauldron, yeah. Sword in the Stone is the Arthurian film that they did.
Yeah.
The Black Cauldron is the dark film they made in 1970, which is...
I think that might be fun.
Ooh, yes, I agree, yeah.
I think on that note, we've come to an end of this episode. We're going to keep rambling.
We're just calling it Disney bashing.
That's final word.
Yeah, that's the title.
The Robin Hood film that they made, I would like to see that.
The one with the hot fox?
Oh, shit.
Yeah, the one with the hot fox.
I completely forgot about that.
Hot fox, but in good CGI.
But they'll never get him.
Make the people who made Planet of the Apes, the Andy Serkis one, and make them do it.
What about Treasure Planet? That would be cool. That's all sci-fi like, and solar punk. You can do that nicely.
Yeah, I agree.
I just saw right
Disney, if you're listening to this, we're giving you ideas for free.
Yeah.
They're making a James and the Giant Peach live
action.
Yeah,
I know.
That's a Roald Dahl though.
Hmm.
What? Wait, this is mind-fucky to me because... Why?
Because why not?
Money.
They made Charlie Ka-ching. And the Chocolate Factory. It did well.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I don't know.
They did Big Friendly Giant. It did okay, I think.
Yeah, it did okay. It's one of those weird late era Spielberg films which I have a whole take on some other
Abbas,
day.
Abbas, how many takes do you have?
I think Abbas is very heavily opinionated.
I am, yes.
That's probably a good thing.
We should do a Spielberg episode soon.
Yeah, okay. I'd be down to that.
Cool.
So with that, we've come...
I'm being told we have cake outside, so we should wrap up this episode.
With that sweet information, we've come to an end of this episode. If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out our other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on IVM podcast on the IVM podcast app or at ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on our social media. Abbas, what is yours?
You can follow me on Twitter @ Abbas Momin, or if you're into pictures, you can follow me on Instagram @ Abbas Momin 88.
What sort of pictures do you put up on Instagram?
You'll find out on my Instagram.
Alika?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram @ Cape Fox Alex.
Shlok?
You can find me on Instagram @ Shlok Chaturvedi.
You can find me and me, Saishree, hi. You can find me on Instagram as Panic Salad or on Twitter as Shroom Salad. Yeah, cool. Bye.
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 Adios.
Think fast. If I tell you I'm Parsi, what's the first thing that comes to mind? Dhansak, I don't blame you. My name is Parzan Patel. You may know me as the Bavi Bride. Though I run a popular Parsi food blog, the truth is I didn't know anything about Parsi food until I got married. It was just my luck. He turned out to be your typical sadralega-wearing, kawab-khari-eating Parsi boy. And the only thing I knew was dhansak, or rather, how to eat it. But there's more to Parsi food than dhansak. And there is more to us than our obsession with eggs and our legendary Rani cafes. Welcome to Not Just Dhansak, a fresh new show where I talk to friends, fellow Babas and Parsi entrepreneurs about all things Bhonu. A little bit of history, a dash of Baba madness, and a lot of food talk. There's more to Parsis than meets the eye, and there's certainly more to us than Dhansak. Join me every Tuesday as I talk to some of my favorite Parsis in the food space in India and beyond. I am the Bhavi Bride, and this is Not Just Dansak.
Hey, this is Shudaditya.
And I'm Amit Doshi.
And we host Shunya One.
It's a really fun podcast where we talk to some of the best entrepreneurs in the country.
Yes, talking about everything from their startup challenges to what they're building and all the future of technology right here.
So catch us on the IVM podcast website, app, or wherever you listen to your podcast from.